Welcome to the Transmission Coaching Podcast, powered by ATRA. Today's podcast is sponsored by Gears Magazine, your magazine for the automatic transmission rebuilding industry. Be sure to get into Gears. Get your free subscription at gearsmagazine.com. Click on subscribe. And don't forget to hit like and subscribe to the Coaching Podcast. And now here's your host, Coach Lance Wiggins.
Welcome to the Transmission Coaching Podcast. It's a great day to fix transmissions. My name is Lance Wiggins, and with me is my co-host, as always, Vanessa Velasquez. Good morning, Vanessa. How are you?
Doing okay.
Fantastic. How about you? Well, it was a good weekend. Still hot. You know, we're dealing with the heat still.
Still over it.
The fair's in town, and so our kids are...
We went to the fair on Friday night. It was my daughter's very first time. She's 8. Has never been. Don't feel bad. And, yeah, it's probably been 10 years since I've been.
The fair hasn't changed.
Still
got the weirdos hanging out there.
It wasn't bad. And it's nice, you know, the town has the free shuttles, you know, where the park and ride, they make it really nice and easy. Of course, a corn dog and a water was $9.
Got a little bit. Sure, you're not at a baseball game? Our kids have pigs there that they're showing tomorrow.
Yeah.
So that ought to be pretty interesting. Mm-hmm. We'll see how that goes.
Cool.
Hey, so along with the expo theme that we're doing, you know, last week we had John Parmenter on from Precision International, and I was thinking, you know, of a good friend of mine, Dan Marinucci, who is the owner-operator, president, and extraordinaire of Communique, who's also done many, many expos for us. I believe it's somewhere out of Akron, Ohio. We're going to get him on the phone here and talk with him a little bit about the expo coming up and about how things are going. Dan, are you on the phone with us?
Yes, I am. How are you, Lance? How are you, Vanessa?
Hey, Dan, we're doing good. Thanks so much for joining us.
Glad to be here.
Heck yeah. So, Dan, I may have misquoted or misheard, but I believe when we were talking the other day that you said something about this will be your 24th expo appearance. Is that right?
Actually, Lance, 25th.
Oh,
my very first appearance at Expo was 1993. I looked it up.
Mm-hmm.
When in doubt, look it up. My first appearance and an electrical class at that was 1993. And so this October will be my 25th consecutive Expo appearance.
Man,
nice.
Oh man.
Well, thank you.
Isn't that like the silver anniversary or something like that? Or is
it
bronze?
Silver.
Silver?
Yeah,
it is
silver.
Silver. Dan, I remember one of the classes that that we had, I think, and memory may serve me correctly or may not, but I think it was at the hotel that the Riviera, I believe, where you did a class on smoke testing.
Was that the Hilton? I do remember class on smoke testing.
And I
remember one of your events being at the Riviera. So I do remember the topic. I do remember an event at the Riviera.
I remember Dan was out front saying, the only place in the convention area where smoking is legal, come on in. And it was a great intro into what he was talking about. So come on in, smoking's great. You can smoke all you want while you're in here. You know,
that sounds like something I'd say. Yeah.
Got to keep that spice going. Uh-huh. Dan, tell us a little bit about, especially for our listeners that don't or haven't been to an expo specifically. Don't know about Dan Marinucci. Tell us a little bit about you, and of course, your lovely wife, Dawn, your assistant, as always. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your company, please.
Oh, well, this goes, my automotive interest and experience goes back to my teenage years, and I grew up in suburban Philadelphia, and I was a classic car-crazy kid in the 1960s, and learned from the older fellows who were turning wrenches for a living, and stayed interested in it, worked in some of the classic full-service service stations when those things really did exist. Then, coincidentally, turning wrenches helped. It, wasn't my sole support, but it helped put me through Penn State University, and I took a degree in journalism. And little did I know that graduating with a degree in journalism and then having that shop experience and wrench-turning experience, I heard about a job opening at Chilton Publishing. Chilton Publishing has gone by the wayside, but it was a big, big, big concern at that time. I interviewed for a job at Chilton Publishing. Turns out it was a technical writing job at Motor Age magazine. And I was there nearly 8 years as a technical writer, technical editor. I got hired away by Hamilton Test Systems, a major manufacturer of engine analyzers and emission test machines, smog machines or gas analyzers, whatever you want to call them. I sold that equipment to the shops for 3 years, and selling to the shops and interacting with them and training the fellas on the equipment was the experience of a lifetime. I got hired back into journalism and relocated to Ohio, communiques on the edge of Akron, Ohio, northeastern Ohio. I got hired back and drawn away from Philadelphia area. I was the first editor of Import Service magazine, worked there a couple of years, and then my wife Dawn and I decided to open our own business. We called it Communique. Initially, Communique was strictly technical writing, writing for the trade magazines, also ghost writing for a variety of companies. Then in 1993, saw the opportunity to do technical training. I tried a class, and this will really date me. The first class we offered was on computer-controlled Japanese carburetors, which at one point were as common could be. Technicians responded very favorably, and we kept going.
Dan, isn't that a oxymoron? Computer-controlled carburetor.
Yes, indeed. Also, and coincidentally, two other big events occurred in 1989 when we started Communique, our little company. One, the editor at the time of Motor Magazine, Wade Hoyt, called me. He said, "We're starting a monthly department called Foreign Service on Foreign Car Repair. You want to write it?" I said, "Sure." So I signed on, and last March marked 29 years of writing the monthly column in Motor called Foreign Service, which focuses on all aspects of professional foreign car repair. And Motor, for those who aren't aware, Motor was begun in the early 1900s by a spry youngster named William Randolph Hearst. It evolved into a trade magazine in the early 1900s and has been going along ever since. So 29 years in Motor writing foreign car column. Then 29 years ago this month, Crane Publishing, which publishes automotive news, Tire Business, Crane's Cleveland business, Crane's Chicago business. Crane is a big commercial and industrial trade publication publisher. Their magazine, Tire Business, goes to the Tire Auto Service Centers. 29 years ago this month, they contacted me, said, "Would you like to write a management column for us?" And there you go. 29 years I've been writing an automotive management column for Tire Business. It appears twice a month.
That is great. Some big anniversaries here, Dan.
No kidding.
That's awesome.
Also, a kind of a dual anniversary. Not only will this coming Expo mark 25 consecutive appearances with Expo, it marks 25 years that I've been doing technical training nationwide with our own classes. Don and I were very fortunate to hunt and hunt and find seminar sponsors across the country. And I've done an array of classes on Asian drivability diagnosis, electrical diagnosis, EVAP diagnosis. And we built the business to the point where at one point or another, I have presented classes in 38 states, including Alaska and Hawaii, and I've done classes across Canada several times.
That's amazing. That's crazy.
You did frequent flyer miles, man.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, indeed.
You know, you mentioned something too that you know, you worked for a full service station, and the way you said it was like, you know, back in the day. The first job I had at 17 years old was the only full service station in Ojai. All the rest of them had already gone to self service, and we did not allow, like the owner said, you know, the customer is not allowed to touch the pumps. Mm-hmm. He's not allowed to open his own door. He's not allowed to check his own tire pressure. That's your job. You get paid for it. $1.85 at the time per hour. Good times.
Yeah. Oh, I, Lance, Vanessa, that's that's a memory for me also. I remember in high school hitting a dollar and a quarter an hour in a full service station. I thought I was the king of the hill. That was
making that money.
That seemed like pretty big money. But you make a good point about the personal service, Lance, because personal service was the hallmark of a good, solid, thriving, traditional service station that actually did service.
Clean your
personal
windows.
Personal service was the hallmark of those businesses. And some of the folks you and I and Vanessa see struggling in the trade, they could learn lessons from those service stations because we were taught to smile, we were taught to greet people, we were taught to always have a distinctive uniform on. Uniform got dirty, you changed it, you were always polishing or cleaning something. Good morning, good afternoon, manners, just every element that comprises personal service, they taught that.
Agree.
And those lessons have, I don't know about you, Lance, but those lessons have stuck with me all my life.
They have. I remember I used to make a game out of it. You know, you get in there, you'd say, what can I get for you today? They give you the old filler up, you know, and you'd plug that thing in, and you'd look at the window washer stuff, and you got your tire gauge in your pocket, and you're like, all right, I'm going for the tires first. Bang, plug it in, and then, you know, and then go for the tires, check the tire, psh, pop it up, go around, do everything, wash the windows. In the meantime, you're staring at the gallons.
Oh.
Kaplink,
before,
you know,
yeah.
And you're trying to get to it right before it clicks off so you can stand there, click, okay, take it out and done, and be proficient.
Sounds like an old school video game.
It was an old school video game.
Have all that done before.
It was called work.
Yeah.
and then you know, and then the lady would roll her window down. Eat. Here's a quarter for you, son. Thank you. That was awesome, man. You never did it for the $1.85 or the quarter. You did it because the people that came in and came out. And then, you know, then you'd barter. You know, back in the day, you bartered for stuff. So it was a Saturday, and, you know, here comes a biker coming up pushing his bike. You go out there, you help him push his bike up. He's like, man, don't have my 250 right now. You pump in 250 worth of gas for him. He comes back and gives you $5. That's a good deal.
You're good,
We'll take that. I mean, that's customer service, though, right?
Well, there's still some states, right, where it's illegal to pump your own gas. I know, like, Oregon, for sure, because I found out the hard way. You're not supposed to do that.
You know, in the time, these 25 years of attending Expo, at various points I've heard presenters, and you've just had such a palette of competent presenters over those years, but I've heard presenters saying, look, transmission specialists, you like it or not, you're becoming more and more of a generalist, because when a car comes in, there are other opportunities to do legitimate repairs on the vehicle. Mm-hmm. The repairs are there, a torn CV boot, a noisy CV. Pick the item. And as long as they're there and you're capable of doing it, you'd be foolhardy to overlook it. Try and sell the work as long as the vehicle is there. And the conversation goes a little further, Lance, Vanessa, and here they are doing a whole car, stem to stern, front bumper to rear bumper, visual inspection, looking for legitimate repair opportunities. And I laugh to myself because I think this is great. One, to me, it only makes sense. And two, once again, Lance, Vanessa, we're going back to our childhood, you and me, Lance, of look the vehicle over. Are there legitimate sales there? And there are countless times there are. And the listener should never forget that it's human nature, at least in my experience. Let's say they do a $3,600 transmission job. Transmission shifts beautifully. But a few miles down the road, it's rainy season, and what do you know? The windshield wiper insert disintegrates.
Yep.
Oh, boy. Listen to that wiper. Mm-hmm. And maybe they're 20 minutes from a service station, 20 minutes from a repair shop. There's a strong tendency for that consumer to say, doggone it, I was just in Wiggins transmission shop, I spent all that money, and look at this doggone wiper insert disintegrating.
Mm-hmm. It was fine before I dropped it off.
That's right. Or I noticed it, and they didn't do anything about it, right?
Yeah. God bless them, some fellows will say, well, Dan, you know, people can be really cruel. And I disagree. My view is people are people. And when someone spent what they perceive to be a pile of money, mm-hmm. those things can become an issue. And as a suggestion, I've said to any number of trans specialists, items like that, how about you put the wipers in, give them the doggone wipers, mm-hmm. give it to them, mm-hmm. and just say, hey,
yeah.
as long as you were in here and as long as we noticed it, those wipers look questionable. We replace them, no charge.
Exactly. It's not about the $20. It's about that trust that you are now gaining.
Yeah, Vanessa, Lance, okay, let's say it was a $3,800 a $4,000 transmission job, and you gave them $50 worth of wipers. The fact that you say, hey, Merry Christmas, an early Christmas present. Mm-hmm. We took care of your wipers. We know you'll appreciate it because we're in the midst of rainy season. Wow, that can light a person up. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Huge wow factor.
It's almost as if, you know, each shop should probably take on the rule of what can we install for free?
Exactly. Right? Exactly.
What can we install
for
free?
That could be a game in and of itself. I mean, everyone loves to give people things. That's a great feeling.
Or even, Lance, Vanessa, another interesting customer relations point that I'll see repeated from time to time is cleaning the vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
Many of the oil companies in the 60s, when they taught customer relations, my first real wrenching was lube oil and filter when we really did lubrication. But the point was, when we were done, you got the old Windex. At the time, Windex seemed to be the popular material, and you cleaned all the windows in the car inside and out. And that was particularly noticeable if someone smoked, and probably half the people we served smoked.
Mm-hmm.
So when they could then see out the windows, wow, what's different? My car's different. It smells better. Plus, you can now see out the windows because you stripped off the nicotine mm-hmm. with the Windex.
Mm-hmm.
That is dirty. It's you're right, but think about it.
Yeah.
So whereas they may not feel a drivability or handling improvement with the lube oil filter service, there was a tangible improvement they noticed mm-hmm. with the clean windows. Mm-hmm. Little psychological step.
I was just going to say, it's also a lot of it is psychological, but the great, great points. And completely agree as a consumer myself, and you know, and you guys as well, I'm sure would appreciate the exact same things. I love that.
I think you and Lance make good points that some of these things can be overlooked and undervalued. And my view has been these are little ways to exceed mm-hmm. expectations. Mm-hmm. And, oh, let's say there's a church league dinner or brunch, and people are talking about what's new.
Mm-hmm.
You love word of traditionally we all love word of mouth advertising, and how about if a fellow tells the brunch group, "Wow, I was at Lance's transmission. Can you believe they cleaned my windows?"
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
That's the kind of word of mouth notice that's invaluable then or now. So
definitely.
So Dan, this year at your 25th Expo, tell us a little bit about the topic that you're going to be talking about.
This Expo, Lance, Vanessa, what I'm going to cover is a little review, concise review of reference voltage testing, because too many times I see very good technicians out in the field making a mistake. And it doesn't matter if they're a transmission specialist or a general repair technician. A problem occurs in the reference voltage circuit. In some instances, it can prevent the vehicle from starting, and these poor fellows get stuck. What the devil? A shorted sensor or a shorted reference voltage wire going to a sensor, either condition, I'll try and condense this the best I can, folks. It can temporarily stun the microprocessor inside the ECM. If it stuns the microprocessor, on the one hand, it may not burn out. In fact, it's not likely to burn out. On the other hand, it won't work. It won't make decisions. And two of the biggest decisions it will not make is, number one, it won't operate the check engine light and give the technician trouble codes. Number two, it won't operate anything else and the vehicle won't start.
Either one are not good. Either one are bad.
Indeed. And God bless them. Vanessa, Lance, I have seen some fellas, 15, 20 years experience. Now, on the one hand, they don't see these shorted conditions every day. But when they do, holy cow. Oh, no check engine light. Well, a fellow can run down many diagnostic paths and run himself in a circle if there's no check engine light. Moreover, if the car won't start and the fellow plugs in the scan tool, and a scan tool says no communication, that too can lead them down some erroneous paths. Over the years, I've seen a variety of ECMs replaced. The condition persists. And Lance, Vanessa, you haven't lived until, for example, I'm out in the field doing my homework. And I come into a shop just about the point where this poor technician has realized that they've dropped several grand on a new computer, ECM, and they got exactly the same condition. You want to talk about steam?
Is it steam or insanity?
So, on the one hand, you don't see a reference voltage circuit failure every day. But on the other hand, I can walk the fellows through some fairly basic voltage checks to do a process of elimination to determine if a shorted sensor or shorted wire has pulled the reference voltage line down and then in turn, I'll use the phrase stunned, temporarily stunned the computer. And so that'll be the focus, diagnosing reference voltage circuit problems. Of course, the computer sends typically a 5-volt reference to the sensor. The sensor modifies it or varies it according to engine conditions and sends an appropriate signal back to the computer. So the 5-volt reference line or reference line can be often overlooked in a very costly, serious way.
Well, you know, Dan, if my scan tool doesn't say there's a problem, there isn't one.
Oh,
heavy sarcasm.
Lance, Vanessa, with all due respect, I well remember, I'm really, really going to date myself. The first scan tool I saw came from MPSI. It was roughly early 1980, mid-1980. It was for General Motors only, plugged into the General Motors ALDL under the dashboard. And starting then, even then, it was scary because I saw technicians beginning to think that their sole salvation was the scan tool. That was 1980. When in fact, many of the problems we encountered, you diagnose them with electric and a voltmeter. So here we are now, how many years later, Lance, Vanessa, scan tool costing $10,000, $15,000, depending on what you're buying and what have you. Mm. And the same thing. In so many instances, for example, a reference voltage failure, there are literally millions of vehicles on the road on which, A, there is no trouble code that will specifically flag a reference voltage circuit failure. None.
Or,
on millions of vehicles.
And,
number two, there are countless applications where the scan tool can't read or doesn't read the 5-volt value. So say, gee, Dan, is the ECM sending that doggone sensor a 5-volt reference value? Is it sending it to 5 volts? The scanner can't tell you that. Your point's well taken, Lance. You have to get off your fanny, open the hood, go to the sensor, and test the 5-volt reference line with a voltmeter. Unfortunately, many fellows put way, way too much faith in a scan tool solving all their problems. Number two, I see a lot of technicians get a little lazy and they begin forgetting their essential voltage checks. And it's a shame when you've got a fellow, holy cow, Lance, Vanessa, a fellow 15 years experience. Joe, come here a minute. Here, let's practice some voltage checks. And you can watch the guy's face and realize he's fallen out of the routine of doing certain essential, I dare not say basic, because fellas hate the word basic. I'll call them essential. They've gotten out of the routine of making certain essential voltage checks. And as you said, Lance, if that scanner doesn't jump up, pinch him on the cheek and say, look here, they won't test further, or they'll be stymied. They'll struggle. It's a shame. So many.
Part of it.
They know better, but they've gotten a little careless.
And I would even go a little further and say that that the majority of the technicians that have the, you know, $10,000-$15,000 scan tool only use probably 50% of the scan tool, if that.
And no disrespect to scanners. The scanners, you read my columns in Motor over the years, I praise the scanner in my classes. However, your point's well taken, Lance. One, they they only use a relatively small portion of it. Some of the fellas, let's not kid anyone. Vanessa, Lance, you go into the shop and you watch this fellow work. All that money invested in the scan tool, you know what it's really used as? It's used as a trouble code reader.
It's actually easier to hook up, go get your $50 code reader and hook that up than it is to hook the scan tool up. That's for certain.
And don't get me wrong, we've got some extremely hardworking fellas out there, and some of the fellas get tons of utility out of their equipment, including a scan tool. Then there are other fellas who, again, perhaps have gotten a little careless, perhaps have gotten a little lazy, and A, they don't fully utilize all the tests the scanner will do. Equally important, perhaps more important, the critical voltage checks with a voltmeter, they've forgotten them. Quick example, someone else worked on the vehicle before you. They left a ground wire loose. Electrical system's going crazy.
Happens all the time.
God bless them. I walk in, helping out. Maybe I'm going to visit the shop to shoot photographs for my PowerPoint presentation or my articles in Motor. PowerPoint presentation for my classes, folks. So I get to the shop, Vanessa, Lance, and we're going to do photography. And a fellow's scratching his head or cussing a blue streak at this vehicle. Maybe he suspects a ground problem. Hand him the voltmeter. Joe, you know how the voltage drop that ground? And you get this deer in the headlights expression. And that's my cue where I say, hey, come on, let's review. I know you know this. You probably forgot. Let's take a look here. But the fact that the technician gives me that stunned deer in the headlight looks when I mention one of the most basic voltage drop checks you could ever make, voltage dropping your ground, it's very enlightening. Reminds me that, on the one hand, as I said, Lance, Vanessa, we've got incredibly bright, incredibly capable fellas out there. And then we got a lot of other fellas who basically good guys, but they struggle because, as I said, it appears they've gotten out of the habit of doing critical voltage checks, and they suffer. Oh, boy, they suffer for it. So, but anyway.
Just makes the courses.
We're going to try and get them on the straight, narrow path to knowing what can go wrong with a 5-volt reference voltage to a sensor.
It just makes your courses all that much more important. That's all.
And Dan, speaking of the fact that, you know, this is now going to be your 25th year at Expo, I'm curious. We get a lot of, attendees that will say, oh, do I need to come back again? I was just there last year. I think I could skip a year. Well, what would you say to those who feel that it's not necessary to go to Expo every year?
Well, you know, Vanessa, you're... Education is costly, but ignorance is far more costly. That's number one.
That's a good point.
Number two, even if you hear to me, and I tease people, but I'm not joking. I say, I don't get out much. But over the years, what I've observed at Expo and at other training classes, sometimes you hear a presenter present the same topic, the light bulb may go off in your head. You may say, wow, now I fully understand, or I understand that topic so much better. This Wiggins fella, for example, he explains it totally different from that Marinucci fella I heard last year.
Mm-hmm.
So, A, you never know what you're going to learn. B, you don't want to be pig-headed and think you know it all already or from it. And three, you don't know, I'm going to repeat something, you don't know what you're going to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And you shouldn't shortchange yourself or shortchange the program. Anymore, I think it's foolhardy not to attend every expo. And I urge guys not to be close-minded. Mm-hmm. You'd be surprised what you learn. Also, Lance, Vanessa, more and more and more shops I talk to, the owner budgets for training.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So in the budget, they're going to anticipate and plan for sending 1, 2, 3, 5 people to Expo. It's not a surprise. Rather, their labor rates reflect that, and part of their training cost is represented in the labor rate. I think that's terrific, and I think that's appropriate for everyone. Knowledge is not free, as a rule, and when you look at all other professional walks of life, those folks, professionals in every walk of life, pay good money to get updated information in their specialty, doctor, lawyer, mm-hmm. pipe fitter. That's traditional.
Exactly.
I think the same should apply to automotive. And missing an expo, you may miss the very presentation, as I said, that turns on a light in your head and really clears up a topic for you. That's what I found.
Great
that's
points.
What I found.
Great points.
It's like watching a movie for the third or fourth time.
Yeah, you're going to catch conversations or something that you didn't before.
That's the way it works, man.
Yeah.
Hey, Dan.
Oh, no. This might be off the topic, but maybe not. But in the mid-'80s, there was my first Coen Brothers comedy, Raising Arizona.
Mm.
And it was only after watching it several times over the years, and we had our daughter, we have a child, it's even funnier if you know the plot of the movie. But at one point, Holly Hunter's character looks at Nicolas Cage's character, and she means to say, my fiancé left me. But she's so stressed out, she says, my finance left me. Dumb joke, perhaps, but as you said, Lance, I had to see that movie 3 or 4
That's
times
funny.
Before I caught that. I caught it, I was on the floor laughing myself silly.
That's
but I had to see it several times.
Yeah, that's one of those. There's a lot of movies that are out like that. Mm-hmm. Very similar to, like I said, just the training aspect that we've come to know and love. So, Dan, if somebody wants to get a hold of Communicate, hire you guys out to come out and give some
refreshers
mm-hmm. and or some new stuff,
yeah.
you know, to their new guys. How
yeah.
do they go about doing that? Do you have a website? Do they have a?
Yeah, very very simple. Go. It's my first name, my last name. Dan, D-A-N, Marinucci, MARINUCCI.com. DanMarinucci.com.
Easy enough.
And they find our site and all our contact info is in there. And we sure love hearing from people. Appreciate the opportunity to chat with you folks, and I want to tip my hat to the technicians and the owners who take their work seriously. They don't have to take themselves seriously,
mm-hmm.
but they take their trade and their work very seriously,
mm-hmm.
and they've come to events like Expo time and time again, put their money where their mouth is.
Mm-hmm.
Take my hat off to them. It's challenging work. If the work, Vanessa, Lance, if this work was so easy, everyone would do it
exactly.
well, but they don't.
Exactly.
So take an opportunity, again, to compliment and encourage those people to continue doing what they're doing, ongoing education, coming to Expo and other
mm-hmm.
classes.
It is commendable. It's not just a you know financial investment. It's time. You know, we've all got other things going on. That's you know, it's time away from their shop, from your lives, your family, and you know, it's a big deal. But it just really goes to show that they are serious and about this industry. And it's great.
I hope I've seen that over the years at Expo, you have hosted many business management and business-related topics. I think that's very essential. I hope people listening take advantage of those. It should not be. It sometimes is a surprise, but it should not be a surprise that professionals in highly complicated, highly technical trades, they require and they embrace education. Education has a cost, and it's not the consumer's fault that the topic or the trade is demanding. So the cost of consumers should reflect the fees they charge, should reflect the cost of education. That's my view. It's the cost of doing business.
That's your 5 cents, and you're sticking to it.
Great points.
Well, Dan, I want to thank you so much for being here at the Transmission Coaching Podcast today. Very informative information, and we look forward to seeing you in late October, early November for our 2018 Powertrain Expo.
Well, I thank you. I appreciate the hospitality and the support, and look forward to seeing all of you, too.
Thank you so much, Dan. We'll be seeing you soon.
Take care.
Bye, Dan.
You too.
Super informative information. Dan Marinucci.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah, danmarinucci.com, www.danmarinucci.com. We'll post it on the YouTube channel and make sure that you can...
Wealth of information.
Check that out. Yeah, that
years and years. We are so lucky to have him at Expo.
That guy has, I think we were talking about, he's probably got 20 years worth of... voltage stream data that is just like I said, he's forgotten more in his than I what is the statement goes he's forgotten more in his little pinky than I have in my whole world or something like that, or he's got more knowledge in his little pinky than I have in my whole world, something like that. So either way, I'm looking forward to having a couple of the other guys. This is kind of building a little bit momentum, you know.
I'm learning so much, and you know, and like I said, you know, especially with, you know, behind the scenes type of thing with what I do, I don't get to spend too much time with the speakers. They know who I am, I know who they are, and things like that. But this is great. I mean, it just proves to me anymore of how valuable Expo is. And my gosh,
I think I've seen, and Dan had said this a couple times, where he's done a couple of shows back to back, whether it was, you know, one time he did central electronic checks, electrical checks in Washington, D.C., then we came out to Vegas, he did the exact same thing, because, you know, people aren't going to travel both ways. But then he did Vegas a couple times, twice in a row, and the guy said, you know, this is the same show he did last year. I said, yeah, you should check it out. He says, why is that? I go, because you probably missed something. And he's like, all right, I'll do it. And he went in there and checked it. Sure enough, he came out and said, that's exactly what happened.
That's great.
You know, you missed things. Or, you know, you take the handout home and you're like, what did he say about this again?
Yeah.
So, you know, it just makes it difficult. Well, this was a good show.
Yeah.
Thank you, Vanessa. It's
of course,
a great day
you.
To fix transmissions. So let's keep fixing transmissions together.
Bye.
Bye now.